here today because our democracy is under attack. The literal counting of the vote is now owned by a private corporation.
Your ballot has been cast.
You know, something's broken in the promised land.
We were extremely pleased with the way our equipment functioned during the recall election.
It would be the first machine in the history of man that was fail-safe.
The results will be accurate and reliable.
How much more damage?
We have a company that lies. Yes, I'll say it, lies.
You could connect to that machine, get complete control over it, change votes, change the software.
This stuff was never corrected.
What in effect you did is create a big complex building, put locks on every door, use the same key for every lock, and then publish a picture of the key on the wall. Does this seem to be a suitable security architecture to you?
A busted deal here in the promised land.
At the time of the most important election in our country's history, we have the greatest doubts as to whether thousands of voters are going to once again be disenfranchised. Only this time, there will be no evidence.
For the first time, many Americans will be voting on paperless electronic voting machines, which are being rolled out across the nation.
To begin voting, press 6.
Election officials are trying to persuade the public to trust this new technology.
How do I know that my vote's been counted?
The memory should have taken it.
But how do I know that it has? How do I know the system didn't crap out?
Nobody knows.
I don't know. This is... Would you like your life to depend on the accuracy of this machine?
This is the first time we're going to use it, so...
Let me ask you a question. Would you like your life to depend on the accuracy of this machine?
No.
Okay.
Bev Harris, a grandmother from Seattle, was curious about the machines and the corporations that make them.
I had some questions about these voting machines, and I started looking on Google. And I wanted to find out how the voting machines worked. What happened next really changed my life. One reason I was so curious is because it's a secret how they work. The companies that make them keep it a secret. None of the computer scientists felt they could even look at the code because the code was supposed to be a secret. The certification labs that examine it keep their process a secret of what they do. And even the election officials who buy the equipment are prohibited by their contract from ever looking and seeing how it works.
Bev did a simple search on the internet for Diebold Election Systems, one of the three major manufacturers of voting machines.
I stumbled upon an obscure webpage which contained the crown jewels for Diebold Election Systems. It contained 40,000 files, all of their programs, that had been sitting there and accumulating for 6 years.
What Bev found on Diebold's unsecured site was the secret software that counted the votes in 37 states. Over 70% of Americans will be voting electronically in the November presidential election, and Diebold, based in Ohio, is the market leader.
The FTP site was an unfortunate situation, I admit to that. It was a situation where that information was out there, it was captured, which was our fault. We made a mistake. and we readily admit that. Will it happen again? No, it will not.
After finding the files, you know, I sort of collected together some various computer scientists, and Dr. Dill, I believe, Dr. David Dill from Stanford, passed the files to Dr. Avi Rubin, who was from a security institute at Johns Hopkins University.
The problem that Bev has discovered is a pretty significant security hole, and it does open the way for people to really seriously manipulate the election in a way that's very difficult to detect.
He examined it and wrote a paper, and by July 24th, it was in the New York Times under the headline, Stunning Security Flaws Found in Diebold Election Systems.
No one had ever had a chance to analyze the code in these machines. The companies that make them keep it proprietary and claim that it's a trade secret. And so we had a chance to see what's really going on inside of these machines.
I teach a lot of graduate level computer security courses at the Florida Institute of Technology. And if someone submitted the Diebold Jam Server version that Bev showed to me as a final project, they would fail. The architecture's just that concerning.
What grade would you give them?
F.
Dr. Thompson looked at the central tabulator for Diebold, which is something that not many people had looked at up until now. It's called the GEMS system, G-E-M-S. And the central tabulator is one of the most vulnerable systems and one of the most tempting targets because it controls the most votes at once. Central tabulators for Diebold are active in 1,000 counties. Each county has one or sometimes two, and they count up to 2 million votes at a time.
Sequoia, ESNS, and Diebold have the lion's share of the market. In fact, ESNS and Diebold alone have about 80% of the electronic voting market. And the two senior executives at those two companies are actually brothers. So it could be argued that there's somewhat of a cozy relationship there.
They keep saying their machines are flawless, there's never been a problem, even though we can by now bring forward solid evidence of hundreds of elections that have been miscounted and that have indeed been flawed.
Why should we trust Diebold?
Accuracy and security and reliability of the equipment. First of all, let me just mention there's a lot of checks and balances in addition to the actual equipment. The accuracy's been there, the reliability's been there, everything is tested before it's ever deployed for an election. Time after time, our equipment has certainly proved to be accurate and reliable.
Diebold has a very strong marketing effort, and they continue to just say their lines, which is the machines are 100% secure, there's never been fraud in an election.
Our company reviews and checks and verifies software for many of the Fortune 500 and for the U.S. government. And so, you know, kind of seeing this thing in software that's going to be used to count votes was really disturbing.
The biggest problem that he found was that there was more than one way into it. There was the official way in, and then there were these sort of secret backdoor ways in, and using those backdoor ways you could alter the results without leaving any trace.
Andy Stevenson was running for Secretary of State in Seattle when he read Bev's revelations on her website, blackboxvoting.org.
But when I first saw the GEMS hack, I was still actually running for office. And my reaction was, bleep, I'm screwed.
So I sent Bev an email offering her to help her in any way that I could.
I asked him to call and find out if Bob Yurosevich was still the president of Diebold, because there was some question about it at that time. They were keeping him kind of under wraps.
So I called his house, and his wife answered and apparently was on a plane, and she said he'd call me back after I said, well, I heard that he's not president anymore of Diebold.
And almost immediately got a call back from Bob Yurosevich threatening him and saying, you better back off or you're going to get a visit.
I said, from who, Bob? The Easter Bunny or Santa Claus? And he says, I'm serious. And I said, so am I. I'm from Texas. I'm not afraid of you.
And so I called Andy up about 10:30 at night and said, you want to take off tomorrow early? And let's go make some visits. So Andy and I took off for a 9-state tour to find out what's really going on.
Bev and Andy discovered that many states, including Washington, were using illegal software that hadn't been tested to check if it counted votes accurately.
You know, it's darn hard to get answers about our own voting system. Andy and I approached Mr. Evan, who's the assistant Washington State Attorney General, and asked him questions about what we do if the Secretary of State certifies software illegally. And he said, well, I defend the Secretary of State, so you can't report it to us.
I don't know if there's anything I can do here. I'd encourage you to take this up with the Secretary of State's office.
They're the Secretary of State's office has lied to us.
They've lied to us.
Yeah.
They're the appropriate authority.
It's a criminal matter if you have a Secretary of State's office who is presiding over the use of software in elections machines that has, is, and the software itself is in violation of our own state law.
Not to my knowledge.
What redress do the citizens have?
Voting. But if the voting machines are rigged, how do we change that? Yeah, that's an issue you have to take up with the Secretary of State. There isn't anything else I can add.
What was your name again?
Jeff Evans.
The headquarters in the United States for the Diebold Election Systems is McKinney, Texas. We took advantage of the fact that they left their trash wide open for anyone to take a look at. And in fact, we found the complete contents of Bob Yurosevich's personal paper wastebasket stash. And in it was a number of documents that were really very important.
You know, one would think that a democracy that is transparent, you wouldn't need to go through an I Spy game to try to figure out how the heck your vote's being counted. But I guess in today's world, that's what privatization means.
Some of the things we got here, Andy, are really interesting. Let me tell you, this one, don't look, you watch the road, I'll give it to you.
Okay.
How did stuff get sent to Canada, get back to us, then get resent to customers as new?
What?
This is a Diebold notation. Here's one from Tippecanoe, Indiana. And they had many concerns. Apparently they were withholding their payment for some reason. And the touch screen units would not upload correctly on election night.
How much more damage can I stand?
It's important your company is impartial, isn't it?
Yes.
Then why did your chief executive officer promise to deliver the votes in Ohio to George W. Bush?
That quotation that appeared in a letter is something that he regrets. It's a situation where his personal preference has come over into his business practice, and he regrets that ever happening. He has committed to keeping a much lower profile when it comes to those types of activities because of that statement.
I have to tell you, my son is grown now. I never thought I was going to have to spend the second half of my life fighting for my son's right to vote. But when I realized he might not have that right, then I just decided, well, by golly, you know, and not if I can help it. We're going to make sure that he keeps it.
Bev's next stop was San Diego, California, where she met Jennifer Hamilton, a poll worker. Jennifer was astonished when county officials told her to take the new computers home with her until the election.
Hi.
Hey, I'm looking for Pam and Jennifer. I'm Bev.
I'm Jim Hamilton. Bev.
Hi, Jim. Are you Pam? You're Jennifer. I knew that. I knew it wasn't Pam. I knew it was Jennifer.
And so you're telling me, just so I understand this right, because this is actually mind-boggling, that 1,600 people went home with voting machines that night.
Yeah, some of them for almost a month.
And could you explain to me the careful background check they did on each person?
They asked us for our name and to sign in at training.
And that's it?
Yeah.
No identification?
No
idea. Well, I would like to know, this is probably a written procedure, wouldn't you think? I'd like to see the written procedure that says, the procedure is, when they come in, you ask for their name, and then you give them a voting machine.
This is my dad, Jim, my mom, Charlene.
Now, where did they put the machines? They put them in the back seat? Where did they put them? All right, so you drove in, you had a car full of voting machines.
Most of them they put in the back seat.
So we're loading up the machines in the car. We got a couple of them in the trunk.
They were all
the machines were lined up against the wall here.
At no point did they ever ask for any form of identification at all. No proof of registration to vote. No proof of anything.
Were there any precincts that anybody knows about where the number of voters who signed in versus the number of votes that showed up was either too many or too little?
Meaning?
We had two machines where the total number of votes on the screen was not the same as the total number of votes on the printout.
Wait a minute. That's the first I've heard of that.
The thing is, though, is that I called at that point because I said, well, there's a difference here between what it says on the printout is the total and what the screen says is the total. And so I said, well, you know, what do I do? And they said, oh, don't worry about it.
Okay, basic said, bookkeeping question.
Wait a minute, what do you mean don't worry about it? We're talking about lost votes because the number on the printout is less than the number on the screen. And they said, oh, don't worry about it.
When the units go through their logic and accuracy testing before they're deployed for an election, and the test goes fine and they're ready to go, they're closed, and there's a protective tamper seal that's placed on every one of the units, and it also has a serial number on it. If those ship to the location and that seal is broken or that number does not match, that unit is not used in that election. So if that has been tampered with in any way, it's pulled.
This is the seal.
Oh, I would like to see the seal. Wait, this is a piece of paper. Okay, but this is a...
The seal is stuck to the piece of paper.
But you could run one of these on a Xerox machine.
Yes, you could.
Okay. And then this particular seal is on regular paper with some sort of adhesive on the back. Stick'em paper. Oh, you know what? You can actually re-adhere it, can't you?
Mm-hmm.
And you can actually take it off, and then you can put it back on.
Right.
It says, though, but it says, the noblest motive
is the
public
good. Yeah.
To cut to the chase, when they say that these machines have been sealed, and so that you can tell that nobody has tampered with it, that is complete baloney.
I was told by some of the manufacturers that they keep the procedures around the security secret because it's much safer that way for it to be secret.
Oh, yeah, but it's certainly not for security reasons, at least not for good security reasons. If they want it to be secret, it's because their security is so lax. I mean, this totally sucks.
Now, the central tabulator is sort of the one machine to rule them all. It collects all the votes. And every company, not just Diebold, has this central tabulator. Because, of course, the way you vote is you vote in individual precincts. They're scattered around. And there has to be one machine to pull all these threads together, add them all up, and pronounce the winner.
Bev was invited to New York to meet former presidential candidate Howard Dean.
Bev sat me down. And in a few short seconds, I was amazed at what I could do.
All right, Bev, show me how to do this.
Well, what we have here is the central tabulator computer. Now, in a voting system, you have all these different voting machines at all the different polling places. Sometimes, in a county like mine, there's 1,000 polling places in one county. All those machines feed into the one machine so it can add up all the votes. So, of course, if you were going to do something you shouldn't to a voting machine, would it be more convenient to do it to the 4,000 machines or to just come in here to one machine and deal with all of them at once? What surprises people is the central tabulator is just a PC. It's like you and I use. It uses Windows. It's just a regular computer.
So anybody who can hack into a PC can hack into the central tabulator.
The GEMS program is the program that is the central tabulator program. And I'm going to put in a password here. Okay, we're in. Now, this is the official program that the county supervisor sees.
The Diebold program?
Yes, this is a Diebold central tabulation program.
Okay.
And then go to election summary report. And it's going to whir and spin for a minute while it adds up all the votes from all the different precincts. And as we can see here, Howard Dean has 1,000 votes. And Lex Luthor has 500, so you're beating Lex Luthor, and we're...
2-1.
Yes, and Tiger Woods, unfortunately, doesn't have any votes yet.
All right.
All right, let's close this out. I was just showing you the legitimate way to go in and look at votes, which, of course, you can't tamper with. Go to the Start menu, and I'm going to show you something tricky.
And I want you to go to My Computer and just click that. And you're going to see some, go to Local Disk C. Go to GEMS, which is the name of the Diebold program. We're going to go to Local DB, which stands for Local Database. That's where they keep the votes. And by the way, this has been out on the internet for ages now. Go to Central Tabulator Votes, which is the database we just looked at. And then go to the sum of the candidates, which is that table. You see we have 800 votes here for you and 400 for Lex Luthor. Let's just flip those. We'll make that 400. And we'll give 100 votes to Tiger. Let's just see what happened here. We'll go back into GEMS the legitimate way. You're the county supervisor. You're checking on the progress of your election. And as you can see now, Howard Dean only has 500 votes. Lex Luthor has 900 and Tiger Woods has 100 votes. We just edited an election. It took us 90 seconds.
But human beings can't see what's happening inside the computers. And so we cannot check the results or recount them.
A voter verifiable audit trail is a paper record of the vote, ideally a ballot, that the voter can review that records that voter's vote. That record has to be saved. It can't be carried out of the ballot place by the voter. It's kept in a secure ballot box like any other paper ballot, and it has to be available for a recount. In a recount, if there's a discrepancy between the paper records and the electronic records, the paper records have to have precedence.
In my home counties, Broward and Palm Beach counties in South Florida, as well as 13 other counties, which make up about half of the vote in Florida, were voting on electronic machines that were incapable of conducting a manual recount in a close election, even though Florida law requires a manual recount. And when we started asking questions of the governor and his appointed Secretary of State, they kept saying, oh no, we can do the recounts, or we don't need to do the recounts because the machines are infallible, which really seemed a bit concerning to me. The last time we heard that a machine was infallible was before the Titanic set sail.
I have met with the scientists about the equipment that they have in Florida. I mean, I gotta tell you a little secret. My bank account. If I make a deposit in Jacksonville, you know, they give me a receipt. I can go here in Washington and make a withdrawal. So it's no big deal. The technology is there. So why is it that you have machines that cannot give us a slip of paper verifying that I voted, so we can keep an accurate account of what's going on?
Louisiana held its first touchscreen election in 1996 using Sequoia machines. Local council candidate Susan Berniker will never forget her election day. Susan narrowly lost and decided to contest the election results and ask for a recount.
Okay, so this is where the warehouse was. They have now moved it since my election. It was back here in these buildings. And this is where I came the day that the warehouses are open to the candidates to inspect. So I came here with an old college buddy, and he is now a TV producer, and he grabbed his camera. We walked in and I asked them to show me how the machine worked. They pressed a button and out came a tape. And the tape had the names of the candidates with a total. And I said, well, that's not... I got that on election night, but how do I know? Where do you have like a mark or something that shows each tally of each vote? How do we go back and tally and count the votes? And they said, well, you pretty much can't. And that is when I said, oh my goodness, what, this is terrible. We can't count our votes, so how do we know this is right? So I just started fooling around with the machine. And it's when I pushed my name, I pressed the button next to my name, and then I look down and I see Mr. Gambaluca's name in the display when I press Susan Bernecker. Shall we do it again?
Do it again.
Yeah. Okay, here we go again. I'm pressing Bernecker. Gambaluca shows up. So we went down the row. We probably tested 15 machines, and I said, you know what? We don't have to test anymore. Again, I'm pressing Bernecker. I got Gambaluca. How easy is it to rig an election where you have a situation in a voting machine that you can't prove the votes?
One way of looking at the worst thing that could happen with an election is it could actually just be stolen. Thousands and thousands of these voting machines are running software written by a small number of people. If one of those people puts something malicious in the software and it's distributed to all the machines, then that one person could be responsible for the change of possibly tens of thousands of votes, maybe even hundreds of thousands.
Since my election, that our state official elections commissioner has been put in jail for accepting money on a fraudulent basis connected with elections.
Georgia is the first state to use only touchscreen voting machines, a $54 million contract awarded to Diebold. July 20th, 2004 was the statewide election day and the congressional primary for Democratic candidate Cynthia McKinney.
Georgia itself has conducted over 300 very successful elections with our equipment. You haven't seen the issue in Florida with our equipment. And quite honestly, the capabilities of our equipment eliminate a lot of those risks, such as disenfranchisement.
We had one precinct today where there were a total of 17 voting machines, but only two of them worked. And so the election officials had to resort to the use of paper ballots. But they didn't have enough paper ballots, so after 25 people had the opportunity to vote, then there were no more paper ballots. This is not the way an election is supposed to run.
Suppose that we didn't have any computers at all, and when you went to vote, the voting booth was separated by a curtain, and there was a guy behind the curtain who would write down your votes. So you just dictate them, he writes them down, and when you're done, you leave without being able to look at the ballot. Most people in their right mind would not trust this process.
I just voted for myself.
Electronic voting is similar. In an electronic voting machine, you don't have a little guy inside the machine taking dictation, but you have lots of people who are involved in writing the software and lots of people who could have touched the software before it went into that machine.
I'm hopeful that my vote will be counted today.
There's no accountability in the process, and you have to wonder why.
How confident are you?
Well, we're backing up my hope with a team of lawyers.
Cynthia's legal team has been called out to a precinct where all the voting machines have malfunctioned. It's in a McKinney stronghold where many of the voters are poor and black.
What we're understanding the problem is, one of the problems, there are several problems here at Snap Finger, and what I've been told is the precinct is hot overall and the machines have begun to go in and out. And several voters have reported problems when they have made a selection of their candidate of choice, another candidate is getting the vote.
I went in, got my little voting card, put it in the machine, went to vote for the candidate of my choice, who happened to be Cynthia McKinney. When I pressed the box on the touch screen next to her name, the box for Luann Levitan got the red check mark instead.
Time of malfunction, 1 p.m.
Wow, 1 p.m.
It's 4:35, 3.5 hours.
Linda, this is Karen Fitzpatrick.
Hey, how are you?
I'm fine, lady, and I wanted to make several clarifications. And the problems were because there was not enough air and ventilation in the precinct.
Oh,
Okay. Not because any human error or anything else, but because of the heat, the systems began to malfunction.
Okay, but for whatever reason, they didn't seem to call our office.
They called from 1 o'clock.
Who did they call?
Their own.
Devote technicians?
Yeah. And nobody turned
up. A number that the director or supervisor of elections gave them to call if there was a problem with the machines.
Right.
They called it from 1 o'clock.
And nobody turned up.
We have no technician at 5:13.
Your office. Mr. Jasper Russell just came up, and actually, he's one of your employees that you probably don't know that's been designated as the machine technician.
Is he working in the pole?
Yes.
Yes, I am.
You're a pole worker.
Yes, I am.
Well, if you are a pole worker, he is a specialist working from our office. So how can you judge what's happening with that Devo machine?
Because it's happening to many of them.
Right.
No, you need to come and talk to him. And you can't issue a statement like that without having a Devo representative out there to test those machines, darling.
Let's just end it, because we're not trying to get you all in.
We watched machine after machine get carted out of her office and loaded in a car and taken somewhere. We actually stopped two guys who had the machines, dragging them across the parking lot. And we said, hey, where are you going with those voting machines? Well, we're Devo technicians. We're going out to replace some failed batteries. This is what I guess we're trying to export to Iraq.
On that day in Georgia, Cynthia McKinney was the only candidate to have dedicated poll watchers in the field. And against all odds, the unexpected happened.
Well, and the outcome was a very positive outcome for me because I won.
Cynthia traveled to the nation's capital to meet Bev and Andy and their team of activists, so together they could get the message out to voters across America.
This is a country where we roll up our sleeves and get it done. And so we're going to be discussing some solutions that are doable, that will put some procedural safeguards in place to at least mitigate the risks.
Well, I mean, this is absolutely incredible, totally credible though, because we know that computer systems are not secure.
We just need to get it solved now.
That's right. We need the electorate to actually get electric about this election, mm-hmm. and actually show up at the polls and vote.
Absolutely.
And have their eyes and ears open.
I'm going to be a poll worker again. I've convinced several other people to become poll workers. My parents are going to be poll watchers, and that's really what needs to be done, is that people need to become involved.
The more people who go vote, the more tampering needs to be done in order to fudge those votes. So if you're worried about it, it's not the time to stay home. It's the time to get out there and say, well, then I'm definitely going to vote, and so is my mother and my sister.
When I talk with a lot of young people, they come up to me, they say they're scared. Older people say, well, you know, maybe my vote won't count. Let me tell you something. We each got to be soldiers. This is an army. We're in a fight. Now, you don't have to go against holes and firearms and other things to get. The only thing you have to do as a soldier, you just got to march to the ballot box. You just got to march to the ballot box. You've got to make sure everybody in your family get out and vote.
Exercising one's right to vote is as American as apple pie. There's nothing Democratic about it or Republican about it in the partisan context. It is the essence, it is the framework from which all of our democratic ideals and principles emanate from. Your right to vote is sacred, and that's all we're seeking to protect, your right to vote and the right to have your vote counted.
You don't necessarily want to run a country or a democracy based on just complete blind trust. If you just close your eyes and say, I just trust, then you might walk off a cliff. And the thing that's so fragile about democracy is that it just takes one mistake. If people just blindly trust and say, but I think it's probably okay that we don't get to look at the software, and we don't get to know how this works, and we're just going to trust everybody to get it right for us, and we're wrong just one time, we could lose everything. We could lose everything we've worked for 240 years in this country. So maybe we shouldn't change everything so very quickly. We should be a little bit more conservative before taking that blind leap.